Hi, everybody. My name is Terry, and I work with the Santa Clara Valley Open Space Authority. And you are in luck because today we have another Terry. So we also have Terry, who's going to share some of her background with you and sharing her story and things like that. So during the presentation today, if you don't mind keeping yourself muted, just in case, you know, like the cat tries to commandeer your computer or the dogs or something, or the kids or the grandkids, it could totally happen, right? That'll help you out. And we can tell the stories and stuff like that. So we'll have three different sets of stories today, and I'll go ahead and start. So one of the things that I think is really interesting is that I love this time of year. I got myself all ready with my leaves, and I just love fall. It's my favorite time. But I'm also, despite my very light skin, I am also Mexican-American. So I was raised by my mother, who is Swedish, and my dad worked at Foothill College. And so my dad's family is actually from Zacatecas. So we were raised with this whole concept of Halloween and Dia de los Muertos and celebrating our relatives that have passed on and things like that. So if you want the spooky stories, those are actually coming in October. So we won't jump the gun on that. We're like, oh no, wait, come back in October. It's not quite October yet, right? So I really love the fall time of year because there's always all kinds of opportunities to meet family and things like that. And I just love the fresh air. And I also happen to love Thanksgiving. That's what I go like, oh, does he look surprised? Oh no, it's okay, Mr. Turkey.
I love turkey.
But the other thing that gives me hope and makes me think about a lot of stuff is if you have ever felt bad about your romantic life, just be glad that you are not a male tarantula. It turns out that this is the time of year right now when tarantulas are actually starting to walk around. Had an opportunity to be out in the parks, you've probably actually seen the tarantulas walking around already. And the good news is that there's actually a old wives' tale or a folk tale that says that if you see a tarantula within 2 weeks of that, there will be rain. So the first tarantula we saw was a week ago, which was still very exciting in bad ways. And so when we saw them in the preserves at Open Space, we got really excited and happy because we're like, yay! Because we do actually believe in this stuff. The first time my boss told me, I'm like, yeah, right, that's not true. And then what happened was it actually did happen. It actually did rain like within 2 weeks, and I did not see that coming. So the thing about tarantulas is this is not to scale. This is my friend Terry the tarantula. See, we now have three Terrys here. So Terry the tarantula. Ooh, this one's actually really soft. Do not do this in real life, okay? They don't like it. So tarantulas will walk around, and it turns out that it's the males that are walking around. So the girls, they basically build themselves an apartment where it looks kind of like a golf club. So they dig a hole down like this, and it's not very exciting. It just has one room. So they have their one room in there. So imagine, you know, she's down in there and she has put these little ropes of web that go up out the front door. And then that is actually where she makes a carpet out of her web, but it's still attached to the web that's down there. So I picture her in this little rocking chair with a remote, maybe she's knitting or something, I don't know. And out on the front door is this beautiful little mat. So that little mat of web, she actually puts perfume all over it. So there's like pheromones, and the pheromones are like, ooh-hoo, oh boys, I want to have babies. And so what happens is that the males, when they get to be about 2-3 years old, they start walking around. So they're looking for the females. And a lot of times, they can't find them. So what happens is they're kind of wandering aimlessly all over the place. So when you'll see them, they'll be like walking across the road or something like that. And you're like, dude, you're going to get squished. And they're like, I'm on a mission. And so they're just kind of doing their own thing and they're walking across the road. And sometimes their butt sticks up like this. And then just when you think they made it to safety, they turn around and come back. And you're like, get off the road. Well, what happens is when he finally finds the female's carpet outside her front door, he's like, a girl. And he gets all excited. And then what he does is he actually taps on the web with his front legs. And it's kind of like knocking. So he does that. And then she comes shooting up out of there like, ah! And he kind of goes, because she's actually a little bit bigger than him. And he wasn't expecting that. So if you see the two tarantulas, if you were to see them side by side, the boys are just, their body's just a little bit smaller, but their legs are longer. Hi, kitty. Their legs are longer. And then the females, their bodies are a little bit wider because they need to be able to lay an egg sac and things like that. So what happens is they sort of do a standoff like this. And he's like, ah! And she's like, ah! What's that? And she gets excited because it's like special delivery. And then what happens is he starts dancing, because if she doesn't like him, she'll eat him. So he's like, ah, please don't eat me. I'm so sexy. Look at my sexy legs. I'm so sexy. Don't eat me. Don't you want to have babies? And she's like, I don't know. I'm kind of hungry. He is kind of cute. So they go like this. It totally cracked me up. I saw it on YouTube. They go like this and they hold hands. And the first thing he does is on the front of his front legs like this, he's got these little spikes, like these little hooks. So the first thing he does is he holds hands like this with her and he reaches over there and he grabs her fangs and he holds onto her fangs with those little hooks, because if she doesn't like him or she gets bored, like halfway through they're deciding to have babies, she'll eat him. So not only did he have the moment where he like was first found the web and she jumped out and she could have ate him, but now they're trying to be romantic and she could still eat him. So it's very perilous. So they're like, oh, like this. And then when everything's all done, what he does is he runs for his life. So if you could actually hear them, you would hear this, oh. Is the only time you ever see tarantulas run fast, okay? And so when you're in the park, you can actually see the grass kind of go like that. And it's actually them like running for their life. And so she'll actually chase them about maybe like half a foot. And she's like, fine, whatever. Ugh, too much effort. Then she goes back down the hole. But the thing is, she doesn't change the message on the front door. So the next male tarantula who comes, smells the perfume, gets all excited, thinks he found a female, thinks he's going to get to mate. And he goes, ding dong. And she goes, ha ha. And he goes, hi, I'm so sexy. And just right then she goes, arr. And she gets him. So she'll just keep eating them until they stop coming. It's kind of like free pizza delivery. So so she has to stay in her little apartment until she lays her egg sac, and they're actually pretty good mothers. We actually have photographs from the park of tarantulas, and like this guy showed me this picture from the Mayfair Trail at Rancho Cañada del Oro, and I was looking at it and I was like, wow, that's quite, you know, that's quite a lot of little spiders in there, because you could see all these baby spiders. Then I saw the leg. And I realized, oh my gosh, that's the mom's leg. I'm used to spiders like eating the mother or something like that, you know, and they don't do that. So they stay in the hole with the mom, and you saw all these tiny, tiny little spiders and this giant toe, basically. And I was like, what? Oh my goodness. Oh. So, could get eaten before, could get eaten during, could get eaten after. That's very perilous. So if you ever felt bad about your romantic life, just be glad that you're not a male tarantula. Oh my goodness. The other thing that's going to be weird is you are going to see a lot of turkeys. They're going to suddenly start showing up and they hang out in the park. And I swear, I think they know about about people's eating habits, because all of a sudden they're all over the parks and they like stayed there. So the person that I'd like to introduce you to today is Terry. Terry, the next Terry. So Terry, if you could go ahead and unmute yourself. There you go. And then, so what's going to happen is Terry is actually our second speaker for the night. So I will leave it to you to go ahead, Terry, and share your stories, introduce yourself.
Okay. Hello. My name is Terry Fergus. And I am a volunteer docent with the Open Space Authority. And I'm from Scotland. And so I'm delighted to be here tonight to tell you a couple of stories from my side of the world. It's often said that Scotland is a land of myth and mystery and monsters. And in fact, we are the only country in the world that has a mythical creature as its national animal. No, it's not the Loch Ness Monster. It's a unicorn. And so we like to be different. If you think about Scotland, it's a land of rugged mountains, windswept moors, and deep, dark lochs. And lochs is the Scottish word for a lake. They have ancient forts and castles and mysterious large carved stones. And actually in my next story, my other story, I'll tell you a little bit more about that. There's something that will be in there. The natural world is very important in Scottish lore. They value things like trees. The rowan tree is associated with the fairies and protection, and there are people who have them rowan trees planted next to their house as a form of protection against harm, and it's considered unlucky to have a rowan tree cut down, so it's one of those things. There's also things like shapeshifters and the Selkies, which are seals that can take human form. And then you've got things like gentle sprites. There's like the Gillydoo, and Gillydoo is a sprite that lives in the forests, and he actually is very protective, and he'll look after children that are lost in the forest. And then, of course, you've got your hags and your witches, and they're the ones who create havoc. And so my first story that I want to tell you about tonight is about the Celtic. And so there are many different gods and goddesses in Scottish lore and folklore, and one of them, and the most powerful, is the Celtic. And she is the queen of winter. She is the most powerful elemental force, and she keeps the balance between death and renewal, and everybody fears her. Fearsome to look upon, this giant crone goddess has only one eye. Her skin is a dull dark blue. Her one eye is very keen. It's as sharp as ice, and it's as swift as the mackerel in the ocean, as they say. Her teeth are as red as rust, and her hair that lies down on her shoulders is as white as aspen covered in frost. So in the time before time, the Celtic roamed the wilds with her nine ice hags. She would drop clumps of peat from her creel basket, and that created the land features that are Scotland. The lakes, the mountains, all of that were created by the Celtic. And so the highest mountain in Scotland is called Ben Nevis. And that is where she actually sits and just checks things out. That's where she has her little resting spot. Now, it is said that there used to be a well on Ben Cruachan, And Ben Cruachan is a mountain in Scotland where there is now a hydroelectric dam, believe it or not. So it kind of falls right into place with this. And what would happen is that every morning she would take the stone slab away to drink from the well. And then at night, she would put the capstone back on. Well, one day she went too far and she decided that she'd just have a nap. And so while she did that, the water in the well just kept rising and rising and tumbling out and over and coming down in streams and torrents down the mountainside. Pardon me. And so when she woke up in the morning, she found that the whole valley below had been flooded with this water from the well. And that's how they say that Loch Awe was created, was because she forgot to put the capstone back on. So she's been associated with quite a few different things. They say that her rule as the Queen of Winter starts at the festival of Samhain. Now, Samhain is coming pretty soon because it's now what we call Halloween. And that's when the misty, icy fog of winter would come through, the freezing colds of November. And her reign would last until the freezing rains of February and the festival of Beltane. She would carry a staff that she struck the ground with, and wherever she struck that, the ground would just turn to iron. It would be so cold, nothing could grow there. She had a plaid shawl that she wore around her shoulders. And so she would go to Corrie Vrekken. And Corrie Vrekken is one of these crazy whirlpools. It lies between the island of Jura and Scarborough. And it is a natural phenomenon. When it's in full force, you can hear it 10 miles away. And this is where she would wash her plaid. And she would wash it until it was white, bleach white. And then she would throw it over the mountains. And that was the hills being covered with snow and announcing the beginning of her reign in the winter. It was said that she kept a prisoner, and she was the beautiful bride. And bride, wherever she walked, grass would grow and flowers would bloom. But she kept her prisoner, and she had her doing all these impossible tasks just to keep her in check. Now, far away on the island of Tiernanog, there was the Lord of Summer, whose name was Angus. And he saw Bride and he fell in love with her right away and decided, I must rescue her. So off he goes on his white horse, charges over there, but the Kailak saw him. And so they had a fight and he didn't win. He had to go home. And so he had to think about how he could do this because he was determined that he was going to set her free. And so he borrowed 3 days of sun from the summer and went to battle again. And this time the two of them met over the Coulins. Now, the Coulins are a part of the Isle of Skye. They are very jagged mountains. And so they had this tremendous battle. And this time, she had to back down. And so the Kailak went away and fell asleep. And, of course, Angus went and found the beautiful bride. And they married and they became the king and the queen of summer. And so they would reign through the summer. Now, all of this time, because the Kailak is an elemental being, she doesn't die. She just goes to sleep. And so she would be asleep under Ben Nevis until it was time for her reign to begin again. And of course, when the winter would come, up she would wake and it would start all over again. And so that's the story of the Kailak. So, I have another story here. which is actually from a book, which is lovely. It's called The Story of the Kelpie. And it's being retold by Lara Dawn. And it has these beautiful illustrations by Philip Longston. And you see that, okay. And I'd love to read this for you. It's really a children's book, but it's just, it's so much fun. Every loch in Scotland, however beautiful, has its dark, cold depths. And every loch in Scotland has its kelpie. But it's easy to forget those dangers on a sunny afternoon. One sunny Sunday after lunch, the blacksmith's children decided to play hide and seek by the loch near their village. Now the oldest brother, Fergus, strode ahead and carved his initials in the tall grey stone. The youngest sister, Flora, covered her eyes and counted. 99, 100, here I come, ready or not. But Flora didn't find her brothers and sisters. Instead, she found a horse. I found a beautiful white horse. Her sisters and brothers rushed out of their hiding place to look, and the most perfect horse they had ever seen turned towards them and snickered softly. Who does he belong to? Asked Flora. Well, he can't be from the farm, said Fergus, not with that fancy saddle. Maybe it's a pretty princess horse, said Angus. Maybe it's a brave knight's horse, said Archie. Fergus looked around. The owner isn't here right now. Who wants a quick shot? I do. All the children put their hands up, all except Flora, who was looking at the wet footprints on the dry ground. Two at a time, Angus lifted Mari and Magnus onto the gleaming horse's back. Oh, there's room for more. The horse is bigger than I thought. He lifted Agnes up. There's still space. You can all go for a ride. Fergus lifted Archie up. What about you, wee one? No thanks, said Flora. Oh, plenty of room for me then. As Angus climbed up, Flora frowned. I think that horse got bigger so you could all fit on. Don't be daft, said Fergus. Come and have fun with the rest of us. Flora shook her head. I don't think that horse. I don't like that horse. I think he came out of the loch, Flora said. I think you should all get off. The horse started to walk towards the loch. No, nice horsey, not that way, said Fergus. Let's go up into the fields. And he grabbed the mane and guided its head away from the water. The horse ignored him and kept walking towards the loch. I can't get him to turn. Jump off, said Flora. Her brothers and sisters yelled, we can't get off. We can't get down. We can't move. We're all stuck. Flora gasped. I know what that horse is. It's a kelpie, she shouted. Remember the old stories?
A picture of a kelpie.
You onto its back and now it's taking you into loch to drown you and eat you. Fergus was still trying to turn the horse away from the loch, but his hands were tangled in its mane. The other brothers and sisters wriggled and struggled, but they couldn't get off. They all started to scream and the horse's hooves splashed into the shallow water. Don't panic, called Flora. Let me think. As Flora watched, the horse carried her family steadily away. She took a deep breath and she leaned against the tall grey stone. Oh, let me think. She put her hand onto the carving and touched it, and then she bent down. The biggest carving on the horse showed an animal rising out of the loch. Wait, she whispered. I found something. A spade, an axe, a sword. They're all made of metal. She looked up. The kelpie didn't have an iron bit between its teeth, nor iron stirrups on its flanks, or iron horseshoes on its hooves. That's the kelpie's secret. This kelpie's secret weakness, she murmured. It can't stand metal. Then she yelled as loud as she could, do you have anything metal? My penknife's in my boot pocket, in my boot, Fergus called back. My hands are all caught in the mane. Oh, I left my comb in the house, shouted Mary. Magnus yelled, I've got the back door key. And he swung the key on its chain and it hit the horse's flank. The kelpie screamed and reared high in the air. Magnus and Mary and Angus and Archie all fell off. But the horse crashed back down and Fergus was still stuck with his hands tangled in the mane. The kelpie trotted towards the middle of the loch. Flora chased after it, hoping to cut her big brother free. Angus hauled back on the horse's head, slowing it down. Flora, splashing through the water, trying to catch up. The kelpie waded deeper and deeper into the loch. Flora reached the kelpie just as the waters reached her waist. She stretched up and slid the knife out of her brother's boot, then jumped up and slashed the kelpie's mane. The horsehair sizzled when the blade touched it. Fergus ripped his hands free and fell into the water. Flora hauled him, spluttering to his feet, and then they backed away from the horse. The beautiful horse began to change into something huge and ugly and hungry. Steam swirled from its nostrils. Waves swirled around its hooves. Its head arched high above Flora and Fergus.
Not looking quite so pretty now.
Fergus grabbed his knife and from his sister and he waved it at the kelpie. We've got a metal blade. You stay there. You leave us alone. The kelpie stood still and Flora and Fergus dragged each other towards the shore where their brothers and sisters stood shivering. And the kelpie watched Flora and Fergus struggle out of the water, then sank into the dark, cold depths of the loch. Soon the children were safe at home, warming up and drying off. I knew there was something funny about that horse, said Agnes. No, you didn't, said Archie. You thought it was a pretty princess horse. You thought it was a brave knight's horse, laughed Agnes. Flora knew what it was, said Fergus. She worked out the kelpie's secret and she saved us. Flora smiled. Let's make a carving on the stone much clearer to warn the next family who play by the loch. And that's what they did. The kelpie stone is still there today, still warning all the local children and perhaps even you, never to trust a beautiful horse with wet hooves. And always carry something metal in your pocket. And that's the story of the secret of the kelpie. I hope you enjoyed them. And so now I'm going to pass you back to Terry.
That was awesome. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So what I have next is I'm going to share this video from Roger from earlier today. Here we go.
Hi, my name's Roger Abe, and well, I'm a San Jose Park Ranger for 30 years, but I'm also one of Terry's docents for OSA. And I'm gonna tell you a couple of stories. First of all, I was born in San Jose, so I'm a San Jose native, but my grandparents, both sets, came to America from Japan. So they're first generation people. So they're called Issei. Their children were born here and they're the second generation. They're called Nisei. And I came after that. So I'm third generation, and third generation are called Sansei. So growing up, I heard stories from, you know, my cultural background, which is Japan. So the first story is going to come from this book called Little One Inch and Other Japanese Children's Favorite Stories. This was put out in the 50s and was translated into English by Florence Sakade. And there's a series of these books which have great stories in them. And the one we're talking about now is called The Grateful Statues. Once upon a time, an old man and an old woman were living in a country village in Japan. They were very poor and spent every day weaving big hats out of straw. Whenever they finished a number of hats, the old man would take them to the nearest town to sell them. One day, the old man said to the old woman, "New Year's is the day after tomorrow. How I wish we had some rice cakes to eat on New Year's Day. Even one or two little cakes would be enough. Without some rice cakes, we can't even celebrate New Year's." "Well then," said the old woman, "after you sold those hats, why don't you buy some rice cakes and bring them back with you?" So early the next morning, the old man took the five new hats that they had made and went to town to sell them. But after he got to town, he was unable to sell a single hat. And to make things still worse, it began to snow very hard. The old man was very sad as he began trudging wearily back towards his village. Here he is trudging back home with his unsold hats on his back. He was going along a lonesome mountain trail when he suddenly came upon a row of six stone statues of Jizo, the protector of children, all covered with snow. "My, my, now isn't this a pity?" the old man said. "These are only statues, stone statues of Jizo, but even so, just think how cold they must be standing here in the snow." "I know what I'll do," the old man suddenly said to himself. "This will be just the thing." So he unfastened the five new hats from his back and began tying them one by one on the heads of the Jizo statues. There's the statues standing in the snow and the old man putting hats on them. When he came to the last statue, he suddenly realized that all the hats were gone. "Oh my," he said, "I don't have enough hats." But then he remembered his own hat. So he took it off his head and tied it on the head of the last Jizo. Then he went on his way home. When he reached his house, the old woman was waiting for him by the fire. She took one look at him and cried, "You must be frozen half to death. Quick, come to the fire. What did you do with your hat?" The old man shook the snow out of his hair and came to the fire. He told the old woman how he had given all the new hats and even his own hat to the six stone Jizo. He told her he was sorry that he hadn't been able to bring any rice cakes. "My, that was a very kind thing you did for the Jizo," said the old woman. She was very proud of the old man and went on, "It's better to do a kind thing like that than to have all the rice cakes in the world. We'll get along without any rice cakes for New Year's." By this time, it was late at night, so the old man and woman went to bed. And just before dawn, while they were still asleep, a very wonderful thing happened. Suddenly, there was the sound of voices in the distance, singing. A kind old man walking in the snow gave all his hats to the stone Jizo. So we bring him gifts with a yo heave ho. The voices came nearer and nearer, and then he could hear the sound of footsteps in the snow. The sounds came right up to the house where the old man and woman were sleeping, and then all at once there was a great noise as if something had been put down just in front of the house. The old couple jumped out of bed and ran to the front door. When they opened it, what do you suppose they found? Well, right there at the door, someone had spread a straw mat, and arranged very neatly on the mat was one of the biggest and most beautiful and freshest rice cakes the old people had ever seen. Whoever could have brought us such a wonderful gift, they said, and looked about wonderingly. Who do you think? There's the old couple with the rice cake, the giant rice cake at their front door. And do you see someone in the distance? They saw some tracks in the snow leading away from their house. The snow was all tinted with the colors of dawn, and there in the distance, walking over the snow, were the six stone Jizo, still wearing the hats which the old man had given them. The old man said, "It was the stone Jizo who brought this wonderful rice cake to us." The old woman said, "You did them a kind favor when you gave them your hats, so they brought this rice cake to show their gratitude." The old couple had a very wonderful New Year's Day celebration after all, because they now had this wonderful rice cake to eat. The end. So, Japanese children's favorite stories. They're not all as cute as this one. Some of them, of course, like other folk stories, have monsters and ogres and things, but this one's very cute. Now, since I'm third generation American, I also have stories since my people came here. So this one is called My Mom and Her High School Diploma. Most of us remember or anticipate high school and graduation as something that happened or will happen in 4 short years. Sometimes life is different. Lola Tezuka Tanaka was born in 1924, the 4th of 6 siblings to Tsunegyo and Aiko Tanaka. The Tanakas were farm workers and tenant farmers, immigrants from Japan seeking a better life. They were poor. All the children had to help out with work or chores. My mom told me in those days, she liked to eat white rice with mayonnaise. As a child, she loved animals. And from what she told me, I wrote this poem. My mom shyly admitted that she was the one grandma had to scold for wasting time playing with cats. She also loved music, both listening and playing with whatever instruments she had access to. Later in life, she encouraged me and my sister in music. I remember as a child, locking my bedroom door to try to sleep in late. From the other side of the door, I could hear my mom break into song. Open the door, Richard. Open the door and let me in. Open the door, Richard. Richard, why don't you open that door? Now that was a popular song among the young people in 1947. So regarding her love of music, she kept the piano and an old violin, I think mostly from memories. And this is another poem written by her mother, translated by me and a Japanese friend. Remember, this is in San Luis Obispo, when they were tenant farmers. Tedious, rainy night at home. I give samisen lessons my daughter so desired. So the samisen is a Japanese stringed instrument, kind of like a banjo kind of thing. In 1942, Lola was a senior at San Luis Obispo High School, but she didn't graduate. She and most of her family, along with all the other Japanese on the West Coast, were sent to an internment camp. They went to Camp Poston in the Arizona desert, where 20,000 people were held out of over 120,000 overall, forced to live behind barbed wire until the end of World War II in 1945. Her older brother, Walter, enlisted in the Army and became a captain in the All-Japanese Military Intelligence Service in the Pacific Theater, and served as a translator, interpreter, and interrogator. Her father was separated from the family for months because he had been a teacher at the local Japanese school. And as a community leader, he was suspected of being a spy for Japan. After the war in 1948, Lola married my dad, Hideo Abe. And there they are, January 18, 1948. Hideo had also served in the MIS as a sergeant in the Quartermaster Corps. The Abe and Tanaka families had met through farming and thought it would be a good match, which proved correct. They were together for over 60 years. So here they are, I think maybe around after 50 years or so. And also in the 90s, I believe, was when Congress recognized units, Japanese American military units, the 101st, 442nd, and the MIS were all awarded congressional medallions for their service in World War II. Remember, these are Japanese men, died for their country, and served valiantly while their families were being treated like prisoners. So in 1992, remember, 1942 is when they got put in camp, 1992, San Luis Obispo High School invited Lola and two other survivors to join their graduation ceremony. These women, all about 68 years old, dressed in cap and gown with all the other teenagers, finally received their high school diplomas. And this is a haiku. After 50 years, her high school diploma, Summer Butterfly, the end.
So I thought it would be fun to let you listen a little bit to this, just a little bit of the song that his mom was singing.
Hey, Richard! I ain't just ashamed. The police is looking for me. I'll get somebody else locked up and get myself messed up.
The door, Richard.
Let me go, Richard.
The door, I let me open the door, Richard. Richard, why don't you open that door?
Now, let's see now. It used to be old step ladder laying around here.
Thank you so much for coming tonight. It's been a genuine pleasure to share these stories with you. And we will return. We will return next month to do this again. Thank you so much.
I live up here. You live up there?
Yes.
Well, why don't you come?